We want you to be part of this conversation by submitting your questions through the Q&A feature at the bottom of the Zoom screen where you're logged in. And we'll be going over questions submitted towards the second half of the program. Today, we're very lucky to have with us Dr. Patrick Nguyen, who is joining us for our discussion on brain tumor clinical trials. Dr. Nguyen is the director of the Center for Neuro-Oncology at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute. He's the chief of the Division of Neuro-Oncology at the Brigham and Women's Hospital and a professor of neurology at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Nguyen is past president of the Society for Neuro-Oncology and previous editor of Neuro-Oncology, which is the premier academic journal in our field. He currently serves as chair of the Medical Advisory Board at the National Brain Tumor Society. More importantly, he has been caring for brain tumor patients for over 30 years, and his career has been entirely devoted to finding more effective treatments for patients with primary brain tumors, including glioblastoma and IDH mutant gliomas. Thank you for joining us, Patrick.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me. I just want to say that I've been voted the world's worst Zoom user. So if things crash, bear with us.
We're doing pretty well so far. You know, many of the patients that come to see us here at the Center for Neuro-Oncology are interested in clinical trials as part of the strategy to treat their brain tumors. Why don't we start at the beginning and we have you tell us what is a clinical trial?
I think as we all know, we need to find better treatments for brain tumors. And so clinical trials is the mechanism by which we can look for better treatments and hopefully eventually the cure for these tumors. So when we're examining a novel therapy, usually what happens is there's a laboratory discovery, a new molecular target is found or a new immunotherapy target. And then companies develop a drug, they test it in animals to see that it works and make sure it's reasonably safe. And then it has to be taken to patients. So the trials go through several stages. The first stage is when you have a drug that's never been tested in patients, you do a phase one trial where you start off with a very small dose and then gradually you increase the dose until you find the maximum tolerated dose. So that's the stage one of the phase one trial where we look to make sure that there aren't bad side effects and then to find the best dose to use as drug. Then we take the trial into phase two. In phase two, we test everybody with a brain tumor at the dose of drug that we think is the best dose to see if there's any activity, to see how well it works. And then if it's promising, it goes to phase three, where we test the drug against the best standard of care. So for instance, in newly diagnosed glioblastoma, the best standard of care is radiation with temozolomide and potentially Optune. And we would test the new drug against this regimen, sometimes adding it on to the standard regimen, sometimes replacing certain components of the standard regimen. And then we see how people do, and hopefully if it's better than standard of care, it'll replace standard of care and get FDA approval.
At what junction in the history of treatment of a tumor should patients consider clinical trials?
Yeah, that's an important question. I think sometimes there's this notion that you don't do clinical trials until you exhaust all your options. But in fact, clinical trials is actually the recommended first choice by the NCCN guidelines. So from day one, it's something you should talk to your physicians about and consider right from the immediate diagnosis throughout the course of the disease. One of the things that's important to remember is that a lot of trials, especially for recurrent glioblastomas, allow you to have only had one or two prior treatments. Mm-hmm. And so if you have a lot of other treatments, including a lot of other standard treatments, especially Avastin, and then if it stops working and you're looking for other options, it's actually really hard to get into a clinical trial. So in many ways, it's better to do the trial first and then save the standard options for later, because they'll always be there for you. But the reverse is not true. If you have too many treatments with standard options, then it's really hard to get into a clinical trial.
Very important point. Thank you for explaining that. You know, many terms that we discuss with patients as we tell them about clinical trials that are available include randomization, blinding, and control arms. Can you clarify those for our audience today?
So a lot of times when a drug is promising and you're trying to seek FDA approval, for instance, you're comparing it to standard of care. So sometimes there are placebos used, and sometimes it's blinded, but you're never getting worse than standard of care. You know, it wouldn't be ethical to treat anybody without best standard of care. So that's the minimum. Sometimes you would have best standard of care and a placebo compared to the trial drug and standard of care. But that's usually how it works. And sometimes it is blinded so that there's no bias, both from the physician and the patient. But at no time in any brain tumor trial will someone get less than standard of care, because that wouldn't be the right thing to do.
Very important to clarify that. Sometimes we talk to our patients about surgical trials, trials that involve surgery as part of the trial. Can you explain the rationale behind those?
So this makes up a significant portion of our trials right now, especially for recurrent glioblastoma. And the reason for that is that a lot of drugs and viruses, but especially drugs, we don't have a good idea of how well it gets into the tumor. And when it gets into the tumor, whether it gets in enough to block the specific molecular pathways that we're interested in. So a lot of these trials, we give the drug to the patient for a couple of weeks before surgery. This is surgery that they need anyway, so it's not additional surgery. And then at surgery, we take the tumor out and we measure how much drug gets into the tumor, and we measure how well that drug can block the molecular pathway that it's supposed to block, or if it's an immunotherapy or a virus, how well it stimulates the immune system. So in this way, we can understand whether the drug is doing what it's supposed to be doing in a relatively small number of patients before taking them into bigger trials to examine them in more detail. I think at Dana-Farber, probably at least half our trials for recurrent glioblastoma involve surgery.
Thank you for clarifying that. And it's important to note that, you know, surgery, when included as part of the trial, is clinically indicated. It is not just done for the purpose of the study.
Actually, just to mention, a lot of you are probably interested in viral therapies, these oncolytic viruses, polio virus and other viruses. All these viral therapies also involve a surgical procedure to administer the virus or to take out the tumor and then to inject the virus into the wall of the surgical cavity.
You mentioned oncolytic viruses as an approach that we're studying here at Dana-Farber. What are the other broad categories of therapies that we're studying through clinical trials here at Dana-Farber?
So for gliomas, there are three major groups of therapies. We understand most of the major molecular pathways that drive these tumors to grow. And so one area of intense activity is to use targeted drugs that block these pathways. A lot of this is being done in glioblastoma. But in the lower grade gliomas, where the majority of them have a specific mutation called IDH, there's a lot of work also on drugs that can block the IDH pathway using targeted drugs primarily. The second area where there's a lot of work is trying to stimulate the body's immune system to fight the tumor, so-called immunotherapies. And these take the form of a variety of treatments, with vaccines, with drugs called checkpoint inhibitors, and with also small molecule targeted therapies. And then the third area, which overlaps with immunotherapy, are the viral therapies, these oncolytic viruses. These have been studied a long time, and initially they were developed to grow through the tumor to kill it, and also to introduce suicide genes into the tumor that allows a tumor to be killed off by chemotherapy or other drugs. But it also turns out that these viruses are very irritating, so they stimulate the body's immune system to come to the tumor and generate an immune response against the tumor. So viral therapies and immunotherapies are really using very much the same types of mechanism.
Oftentimes when we discuss trials with patients, a recurrent question is, what trials are promising? What of all these available trials, which one is the one that you think would work? Do we have that information ahead of time? You know, how do you approach that question with patients?
Yeah, it's an important question, but it's also a really hard question. You know, if we knew which was the best trial, we would just tell you to do that one trial. The problem is often there are several trials that are promising, but we don't know the results yet because the trial is going to tell us which one is better. I think that's where it helps to have your neuro-oncologist guide you as to which of the sometimes multiple choices that you have for clinical trials. Sometimes we have a feel of which one might be better. Sometimes we don't, but that's where you should work closely with your neuro-oncologist to get their guidance.
What other elements help you decide what is the best trial for a patient when you advise patients about trials?
I think if you had a choice about trials, you ideally would do a trial that's at least in phase two because you know the right dose. But having said that, a lot of the most promising cutting edge trials that are entering clinical use are in phase one. So, you know, we have a lot of phase one trials that where the some of the hottest approaches are being examined. But if we know the dose, it's preferable. And then I think there are a lot of other factors that help determine which trials are appropriate. Sometimes if the tumor is in an area that can be resected again, then these surgical trials might make sense. Factors like the molecular makeup of the tumor would help determine whether some molecular drugs would make sense and others won't. Even though there's a lot of interest in immunotherapies, sometimes it's not possible to do the immunotherapies. For instance, many people are on high doses of steroids for the swelling around the tumor. And if you're on steroids, it can help the tumor, but it also suppresses the immune system. And so immunotherapies are probably not going to be very useful. So there are a number of factors that are taken into account to help guide you, your physician, in how they advise you and which trials would make sense and which ones wouldn't. The other thing I think a neuro-oncologist can help you with is to try to sequence the potential trials so that you can maximize your options down the road. You know, sometimes there are different trial options, but by pursuing one path, it makes it very hard for you to do another trial ever again. For instance, trials that use Avastin early on. It doesn't mean that it may not be the right choice in the end, but if you had other options, that might be something to think about first.
Very, very important point there. You know, patients often have practical questions about clinical trials, and you know, sometimes hesitancy to enroll in a trial is based on potential side effects that they might experience from the trial treatments. How much do we know in advance about side effects of these potential treatments?
A lot of times we have a fairly good idea of the side effects, because even in phase one trials, the majority of them have been tested in patients with other cancers. So usually we will have a very good idea of the whole range of side effects. The exception to this are the first-in-man trials, where for the first time ever it's being done in glioblastoma. There we have less idea about the side effects, but there's often a lot of studies in the laboratory that look at potential side effects, and we can also get an idea of the side effects from similar drugs that have been tested in patients. So usually we have a fairly good idea of the side effects, and it's really important to talk to your doctor about these side effects, because as much as we want to help you fight the tumor, it's important to balance the side effects and the quality of life.
Yes, very much so. And for patients to know that if they experience significant side effects, they will, they can come off the trial. And this is often done for patients with side effects. In terms of other practical considerations, do patients enrolling in trials need to have additional visits? Do these visits need to be done at the center where the trial is run?
Yeah, it depends on the phase of the trial. Some trials require relatively few additional visits. These are usually the phase three trials and some phase two trials. But the early phase trials, the phase one trials especially, where we are trying to make sure that there aren't unexpected side effects, patients are usually monitored more closely. And usually in the first month, there may be more frequent visits. One of the efforts we've tried to lead in the field together with the National Brain Tumor Society and a number of other groups is to try to change the way we do trials so that patients have to come to the brain tumor center less often. COVID has taught us that often we can do a lot of these visits by video conferencing. And so we're trying hard to change the way trials are being done so that patients don't have to come quite as often. But it doesn't mean that there are probably still more visits than if you did standard of care.
And are all these additional visits included by insurance, and the cost of the trial also covered by insurance?
Yeah, so usually not 100% of the time, but the visits are covered. Usually the trial drug and all the extra testing is covered by the trial, and all the standard treatments, such as the regular MRI scans, routine blood tests, and routine visits are covered by insurance. But that's an important thing to check beforehand, but it's uncommon for the insurance not to cover.
Thank you, Patrick, for a terrific overview of the mechanics of clinical trials and all the different elements that patients need to consider. Let's spend some time now talking about some of the exciting research that is going on here at Dana-Farber and some of the trials that you are leading, for example, for the treatment of glioblastoma.
So as I mentioned, that there are three main categories of these trials. There are trials with targeted therapies. Until recently, none of these targeted therapies were working very well. But now in small subgroups of patients with glioblastomas with specific mutations, like the BRAF mutation, the NTRK fusion, the H3K27M mutations, there are now drugs that are showing real promise and potentially might get FDA approval. And so we're involved in all these trials. There are also novel trials that are being done to try to get the answer quicker and more efficiently than traditional trials. And some of you maybe have participated in trials called INSIGHT or GBM Agile. These are national or international trials that look at predominantly targeted agents for glioblastoma. With immunotherapy, there's a lot of work here. Scientists at Dana-Farber actually helped discover the PD-1 antibody that won the Nobel Prize a couple of years ago. So one of the things though that we found with glioblastomas is that unlike melanoma and lung cancer, there are not a lot of immune cells within the tumor. There are not a lot of T cells within the tumor that can help kill these tumors. So glioblastomas are considered what's called cold tumors with very few T cells. And a major effort currently is to combine treatments to try to make these cold tumors into hot tumors and respond better to the checkpoint inhibitors that have made such a difference in other cancers. So we have many approaches. One important approach is to make a personalized vaccine called Neovax and then combine it with a checkpoint inhibitor. Another approach is to combine viruses with checkpoint inhibitors, to look at different combinations of checkpoint inhibitors, or to use radiation or targeted drugs with checkpoint inhibitors. So all these approaches are in clinical trials here at Dana-Farber. And then, as I mentioned earlier, there's a lot of work led by Dr. Chioka, the chair of neurosurgery here, looking at different types of viruses, either alone or again with checkpoint inhibitors. And then, so this is for glioblastoma, and then for the very important areas of lower grade gliomas, grade 2 and 3 gliomas, there's a lot of work targeting IDH in these tumors. There's also a lot of work on brain metastases in collaboration with our colleagues in lung oncology and breast oncology. And then the other area where there's a lot of work is in the relatively rare tumor called primary CNS lymphoma. The research in lymphoma and hematologic malignancies over the past few years has just exploded. And many of these advances can also be used for primary CNS lymphoma. So Dr. Nayak, who runs the CNS Lymphoma Center in our group, is leading many of these trials, and they're seeing really hopeful results for these tumors. So there's a lot of areas that are being worked on.
Thank you, that's a terrific overview. And yeah, as we posted on the initial slide, if you wanted to have a consultation with one of us and discuss the specifics of any of these trials, you're welcome to reach out to us to our number here, and we'll be happy to meet with you to discuss. I want to take some time now to go over some of the questions that we have here on the chat and have been submitted earlier via email. Audience member tells us, I was in a clinical trial after having a GBM resected in 2017. Much to my surprise, when it ended earlier this year, I learned I was on the placebo and not on the nivolumab arm. I guess this is an immunotherapy trial. Is there a chance that I could get that drug if it's shown to be effective when my tumor progresses?
So nivolumab can be obtained. It's not an FDA-approved treatment for glioblastoma, but the companies have been pretty good at providing the drug. The problem with nivolumab, which is a checkpoint inhibitor, it's a PD-1 antibody, is that we know from the trials, both the trial that you took part in and also other trials, that on its own, it's not very effective because there are very few immune cells, very few T cells within the tumor for this nivolumab to activate. And so, as I mentioned before, the current types of trials are to combine things with drugs like nivolumab to try to increase their likelihood of being helpful. But, you know, for everybody who takes part in trials, we're so grateful because we're never going to get a cure for glioblastomas unless patients enroll in clinical trials.
Certainly. There's another question here. I had an AVM, an arteriovenous malformation in the brain removed, and a plate inserted with a coil, I guess a metal plate. So I'm only allowed to have CAT scans for my follow-up GBM appointments. My question is, can patients who are only allowed to have a CAT scan be considered for clinical trials? And perhaps we can talk also a little bit about how we manage, how we measure response to trial therapies on this question.
That depends on how the trial is written. Unfortunately, a lot of trials require people to be able to have an MRI. The main reason for that is that, you know, we want to know if the treatment is helping you. And if it's not helping you, then we should be stopping the treatment. And if it's helping you, it's important to measure how well it's helping you. And the MRIs are much more sensitive and gives us a much clearer picture of what's happening with the tumor. The CAT scan gives us a rough idea, but the tumor has to change quite a lot for us to tell that it's not helping. And so that's one of the reasons that some trials will only allow people with MRIs, but that's not true for all trials. So there may be some trials that will allow people who can only have CAT scans to join. One of the other things, though, in thinking about treatments is that even though joining a trial would be the ideal thing to do, sometimes the drug that's being tested in the trial is available for other cancers, is FDA approved for other indications. And sometimes your doctor may be able to get the drug off label if the insurance will cover it. Or sometimes if insurance won't cover it, we can sometimes get it on a compassionate basis by writing a compassionate use protocol. So sometimes you can do what's in a trial outside of a trial.
Yeah, important to know that option and discuss that with your neuro-oncologist. There's another question here. When trials include age as a criteria, is this typically a rigid requirement or is there some flexibility? For example, in a trial listing a cutoff of adults up to 39, would a 40-year-old be absolutely excluded?
It depends a little bit on who is the principal investigator of the trial. Some are less rigid than others. Trials that are run by the National Cancer Institute, for instance, are very rigid. They don't allow any exceptions.
I see.
But trials that are run by institutions sometimes will allow a little bit of leeway.
Another important question here. I was under the impression that a patient would not be eligible for most clinical trials until you did radiation and or chemo. Is that not true?
So it depends on the tumor. For glioblastomas, radiation is the best treatment we have. So everybody should get the radiation. There are a lot of trials that add agents to standard of care radiation and temozolomide. For those patients with glioblastomas that have the unmethylated MGMT, where the temozolomide is somewhat less helpful, there are many trials that drop temozolomide and replace it with the experimental agent. The situation is a little different for low-grade gliomas, grade 2 and 3 gliomas, but especially grade 2 gliomas. There, a lot of trials don't require you to have had radiation. So you can often get into trials even if you've not had the radiation.
Very good. And actually, the next question is related to what you just said, Patrick. You know, the question is, are there any treatments for low-grade thalamic glioma other than monitoring? So I guess this is a patient that has a thalamic low-grade glioma and they're monitoring. So any thoughts on that one?
I think the best standard treatment is still radiation and perhaps with chemotherapy. But it could be closely monitored. That's an option some people choose. I think if it was possible to biopsy the tumor, then you can see if there are specific molecular alterations that might help choose other therapies. Thalamic gliomas are less likely to have the IDH mutation. They might have the H3K27M mutation. And if they have that, then there are some drugs that are being tested in clinical trials right now for that.
And actually, from a different participant, the question is, do you have any view on ONC201 and ONC206 for the treatment of diffuse midline glioma or diffuse intrinsic pontine glioma? Is there any news on this specifically? So these are tumors that often have that H3K27 mutation. Yeah. What are your thoughts on this?
So we took part in the original ONC201 trial. Initially, actually, that drug was being used for all glioblastomas. And we looked after someone here that had a thalamic glioma, and she had a response to the ONC201. And when we sequenced her tumor, that we found the H3K27M mutation. So that was how ONC201 became a drug for H3K27M mutations. It's being tested in a couple of big trials now in recurrent glioblastoma. And in the next year or so, we will know the final results. But there are responders. It's about 25%. So it's not as high as we would like. But for those people who respond, it's a real benefit. And the drug is really easy. Some targeted drugs can be very difficult with side effects, but this drug, most patients don't really know that they're on anything. So that's an important thing too. ONC206 is a second generation drug that targets the same pathways, and it's being tested in a phase 1 study at NIH. So it looks good in the lab, but I don't know what their results are in patients.
We have another question about the role of Avastin and other VEGF inhibitors. And I imagine the question is the role in general in the treatment of gliomas.
So Avastin, as most of you know, is an FDA-approved drug for recurrent glioblastoma. And it's a very useful drug for helping the swelling around these tumors. When we give it to patients, it helps the swelling within days. And very often, we can reduce the steroid dose significantly and often take patients off steroids. So that's a real advantage of Avastin in terms of improving symptoms and improving quality of life. Unfortunately, it doesn't have much of a direct effect on tumor growth. So in terms of prolonging life, it's less helpful in that area. But it's usually a very well tolerated medicine. So most people who go on it initially will have improvement in their quality of life.
We have a question here about a drug called tiramiprocol. And the question is this drug related to Timodar?
Tiramiprocol?
Tiramiprocol, exactly, yes.
I think this is being examined through the Adult Brain Tumor Consortium. It's a molecular drug that hits multiple targets, so it's not a chemotherapy, and it's not really related to temozolomide. Temozolomide is a standard chemotherapy that kills the tumor cells by affecting the DNA of the tumor cells.
Very good. We have a question about cannabinoids. Are cannabinoids being studied? If so, are there any phase 2 or further along trials using cannabinoids?
Yeah, cannabinoids have been studied to some extent in gliomas especially. There is some preclinical data that adding cannabinoids, for instance, to radiation may help preclinically. But we don't know how well it works clinically. There has been at least one small phase 2 trial in recurrent glioblastoma done in England, where the addition of cannabinoids to temozolomide seemed to be helpful. But the study was very small, and there were a lot of methodologic issues with that trial, so it's hard to know if that is really true. I think it's an area that deserves to be studied a lot more. but right now there are relatively few studies. I think the other challenge is that it's not just CBD. You need the THC as well, and what's the right ratio? All those things are not very well worked out.
Exactly.
But it's certainly an area that deserves more attention.
Yes, yes. It's a common question, and you know, there are no good data for us to guide patients on that form of treatment. There's another important question here. You mentioned that you recommend doing trials before standard treatment, but generally what happens is that they want you to start right away with standard treatment. What can you do about this? How do you know what trials are available before you start treatment, standard treatment for glioblastoma?
I think there's usually time. So at diagnosis, a lot of studies have shown that so long as you start the radiation within 6 weeks of the surgery,
exactly,
the outcome is the same. So even though intuitively you'd feel I should get going quickly, so long as you start before 6 weeks, it's okay. And so you have up to 6 weeks to get into a trial. And then at every point along the path, if there's any change in your scan, I think it's worth trying to get an opinion before you jump into the next treatment. Usually you can wait, you know, at least 2 to 4 weeks before you start your next treatment. And nowadays with Zoom visits, it's pretty easy to get consultations. You know, you don't have to start the treatment the next day. So I think if possible, it's worth exploring all the options. You may end up deciding that standard therapy is still the best option, but at least you haven't gone ahead and done it without knowing what your choices are.
Exactly. Yes. And we're always happy to discuss with patients what's available. You know, this is a glioblastoma, for example, is a tumor that requires additional treatment, no question about it, after resection. But as Patrick mentioned, there is often time to look into other options.
I mean, another at Dana-Farber, we actually have a rule that was, in theory, supposed to have patients be able to make an appointment and be seen the next day. I think right now the challenge is to get the scans here quickly enough.
Exactly.
That's really the limiting factor during this COVID period. But in theory, you can get an appointment the next day and get a consultation. So it shouldn't be a block to you looking at all the choices that are available.
Another viewer is asking us, are there any trials ongoing looking at drugs that would help enhance the activity of the chemotherapy that is used for glioblastoma?
There are trials going on. We have a trial with a drug called ibutilast that works on the immune cells in the tumor. And in studies done by scientists in Australia, they were looking for drugs that help temozolomide work better. And when they did a screen of thousands of compounds, ibutilast came up top of the screen as something that could help temozolomide. I think it also potentially also activates the immune system, so it has a secondary effect. Another area of research that is also picking up pace is to look at agents that target the DNA damage response. So chemotherapies like temozolomide damage the DNA, and that eventually leads to killing of the tumor cells. That's true also of radiation. But many tumor cells learn to repair the damage, and so they survive the treatment and become resistant. So there are a lot of agents that block this DNA damage response, increasing the susceptibility of temozolomide and radiation to these molecular drugs. And so there's a lot of activity there. For instance, for radiation right now, we have a trial with a drug called AZD1390 that blocks the DNA damage and increases the sensitivity of these tumor cells to radiation.
The same viewer is asking, will these targeted therapies be available to patients who have just completed standard treatment? And I don't know if that means just radiation with concurrent temozolomide or adjuvant temozolomide as well, or they're in the adjuvant phase.
Yeah. So for glioblastomas, there are three times when you can join a trial. One is from day one, before you start radiation, where you might add something to the standard regimen. The other common area is in the future, if the scans show changes after standard therapy. But there are a small number of trials that are available right after you finish radiation and temozolomide, before you go on the monthly temozolomide. So the abutilast trial that I mentioned, for instance, we add this drug to standard monthly temozolomide. So there are small numbers of trial in that window also.
Very good. Someone is asking, is there a difference between a trial and a study? We are using those terms synonymously, essentially. Another question is, we're considering the CGAD vaccine, which is said to function best with checkpoint inhibitors. Is it possible to get access to checkpoint inhibitors outside of a clinical trial setting?
Yeah, so in the US, it depends a little bit, but a lot of insurance will not cover the checkpoint inhibitors because they're not FDA approved for glioblastoma. But probably more than 50% of the time, after you get a couple of denials from insurance, you can apply to the drug company and they will give the drug. So we've been able to get the checkpoint inhibitors for our patients in about at least half the time, perhaps a little bit more.
Patrick, another question is about cytomegalovirus, CMV. Do you have any thoughts or approaches involving the targeting of CMV?
I think CMV is a reasonable target. It's a controversial area because there are two aspects to CMV. One is the idea that CMV is causing glioblastoma, and you can treat it with an antiviral agent. That, I think, is not really supported by the data. But the other aspect of CMV is that the majority of glioblastoma cells express the CMV antigen. And so there are vaccines, in fact, there are multiple vaccines being developed that target a glioblastoma tumor cells because they express the CMV antigen. So we have a vaccine trial called VB1901 that we just finished the phase one, and we're actually planning with the company to do a randomized phase two. And that vaccine targets glioblastomas because they express the CMV antigens.
Very good. I want to tell the viewers that if you're interested in immunotherapy options and want to learn more about vaccines, you can also join us for our next Neuro-Oncology Conversations on April 22nd, where Dr. David Reardon, our clinical director here, will be discussing immunotherapy and vaccines as well. A question that we get is, why does Avastin make someone ineligible for most clinical trials? Are there any trials or trial drugs that can be used post-Avastin treatment?
I think for two reasons. One is that the tumors tend to be fairly resistant after Avastin. So unfortunately, it's hard to treat tumors once they grow on Avastin. I think the other thing about Avastin is that it interferes with wound healing. So trials that involve surgery are more complicated once you've received Avastin. Usually you have to wait 4 weeks from your last Avastin dose before you can have surgery. So those are the two main reasons why it's hard to join a trial with Avastin. It's not impossible. There are trials. For instance, our herpes virus trial that Dr. Chioka is leading allows you to have had Avastin before. And we actually have a trial looking at re-irradiation with a checkpoint inhibitor and Avastin in people whose tumors are growing through Avastin. So there are some trials that allow this.
What are some elements that would make a neuro-oncologist stop Avastin if it's being given to a patient?
I think the Avastin is there to help you. And so if the tumor is growing and it's no longer helping, then of course it shouldn't be continued. And then also the other major reason is if it's causing a lot of side effects. Usually Avastin is well tolerated, but sometimes in a small minority of people, it makes them pretty tired, and that can be a problem. And then the rare serious side effects of bleeding or bowel perforation. If either of those things happen, then the Avastin would be stopped.
We get a very important question now. Will patients be safe to receive the COVID vaccine?
Yeah. I think that there are very few exceptions, but if you can get the COVID vaccine, you should do it. It's a really good thing to get.
Yeah.
And it doesn't interfere with your treatments, and you're not prone to getting more side effects from the vaccine, regardless of the treatments that you're on.
Very good. Thank you, whoever asked that. That's an important question, something that we've been trying to communicate to our patients who would like them to be vaccinated, and it would make them safer. If you have an unmethylated IDH wild-type glioblastoma and you get switched out of temozolomide, what takes its place? How efficacious is the replacement?
So the standard of care is radiation and temozolomide, even for the unmethylated MGMT patients. But the benefit of the temozolomide is unfortunately very modest. And so in the context of a clinical trial, it's very common now to drop temozolomide and replace it with the experimental agent in the hopes that the experimental agent will be more effective than the temozolomide. And especially with immunotherapies, this is being done very commonly, because the other downside of temozolomide is that at the standard doses we use, it does suppress the immune system and it lowers the lymphocyte count quite substantially. And so for immunotherapies where you need a good lymphocyte count, that's particularly important.
Another question that is an interesting question. Are there any options for after completion of standard therapy, but before the onset of recurrence?
Right now, that there's no proven treatment in that situation. There is one FDA-approved treatment called Optune, the Tumor Treating Fields, where you start after radiation and you give it with the monthly temozolomide. But when the monthly temozolomide is stopped after 6 months, you often continue with the Tumor Treating Fields until the tumor grows again. But in terms of adding something when the temozolomide is finished, unfortunately, right now, there's nothing that's proven to be useful.
We have a question about Lynch syndrome. Does an MSH6 genetic variant impact the likelihood of being a candidate for a brain tumor trial?
So in some ways, it might make you more likely to be a candidate. So the MSH6 mutation makes it unlikely that the temozolomide chemotherapy is going to be very helpful. But because of that mutation, the tumor themselves actually often have extra mutations. They're called hypermutated tumors. And potentially it makes them more susceptible to immunotherapies, especially the PD-1 antibodies like nivolumab and pembrolizumab. So there are some studies that allow people with Lynch syndrome to join and try to treat them with immunotherapies.
Thank you. We have another question here. Are there any research programs looking at enhancing the proportion of temozolomide that is delivered across the blood-brain barrier?
So we have a trial here with focused ultrasound, We all have this blood-brain barrier that protects our brain from toxins in the environment, but it also keeps out most of the cancer drugs that we would like to use for brain tumors. Temozolomide, our best chemotherapy, achieves a concentration in the spinal fluid of about 30% of what's in plasma. So not everything in the blood actually gets to the tumor. And so theoretically, if we can improve the concentration of temozolomide in the tumor, it might be helpful. Focused ultrasound is an experimental treatment. You lie in a machine that's like a CAT scan, and the ultrasound, together with an injection of saline with microbubbles, opens up the blood-brain barrier for several hours. So afterwards, you can administer temozolomide or some other treatment. And since the blood-brain barrier is open, more of the drug theoretically can get into the tumor. So this is being looked at with temozolomide. We're about to open a trial with a standard chemotherapy with carboplatin. And then there are trials planned with immunotherapies as well.
Very good. There's a question about this presentation. Yes, this presentation will be available and posted online on our website, Dana-Farber, for your review after we complete the program today. We're coming to the end of the hour. So Patrick, are there any specific take-home points that you want to leave our viewers with, or any messages for our patients and families that are watching?
Having done this for a long time, I think the research has really progressed. And I think I'm more hopeful today than I've ever been that we're close to finding really good treatments for these tumors. I think these trials are critical to finding those treatments. And we're so grateful to those of you who have joined these trials to help the science, but especially to help everyone else with this problem. I think one of the goals of these seminars is that when we talk to you in clinic, there's so much time pressure and there's concerns about what the scan shows and side effects. And I think these webinars are hopefully a way for you to find out more about trials, but also about other topics. So I think if there are things that you want us to talk to you about, please let us know, and we will have more of these. Every year, we also have a Living with Brain Tumor conference that we used to have in person, and hopefully next year we'll be able to go back to doing that. But until then, these webinars are a way to try to spend time with you and try to answer questions that you may have about any aspect of neuro-oncology. So please let us know what you'd like to hear. And Nick has done a great job in organizing these seminars.
Thank you so much, Patrick. This has been a terrific discussion. Thank you to all our viewers. There are two questions at the end of the webinar when you can leave us some feedback about other topics that you would like us to discuss through this series. And I want to invite you again to our next Neuro-Oncology Conversations on April 22nd, that's a Thursday. It will be at 4 p.m. and it will be led by Dr. David Reardon, who is the clinical director at the Center of Neuro-Oncology, and someone that has a lot of experience and has been leading a lot of different research trials on immunotherapy. So it will be about immunotherapy trials. We'll be talking about vaccines. So I hope you can join us for that discussion as well. If you would like us to look into your particular case and discuss specific trials, I encourage you to reach out to our center to make an appointment, and we'll be happy to meet with you and look into your case. So we'll see you in approximately a month, and thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, Patrick.
Take care. Bye-bye.